Hello, 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 hello. Thank you, everyone, for coming back more or less in time after lunch. We're entering our next artist conversations with a section dedicated to the Tropics. To do that, I'm going to put my Mangueira t-shirt that I bought in a... To tropicalize this a little bit. Mangueira, Adriano, you know better than I, is it a mango tree or a mango plantation? And it's a favela in Rio de Janeiro, which changed the life of artist Elio Itizica, his contact with the Mangueira, with the Samba of the Mangueira, and the men of Mangueira. Totally changed his approach to art. And the colors of Mangueira are pink and green, so well, this is a little advertisement. The section of the Tropics is one of the different sections in the exhibition upstairs. In a way, it really takes the idea of the Tropics in order to de-exoticize it. You know? Working with the Tropics not as an exotic idea, but working it from within, artists working critically and aesthetically, understanding the place where they are. So as part of this theme, we are very honored to have Marilys Downey, wife of artist Juan Downey, who is represented in the exhibition, and Gilda Mantilla and Raimond Chaves, whose work on and research on the Amazonic Library of Iquitos also kind of expands our understanding of tropical production. And as you see, it goes beyond the tropics. The inclusion of the work of Juan Downey was of utter importance for me, for the exhibition. Originally, when the MAP project was presented to me, the idea is that it would be a program of acquisitions, basically of younger, let's say, emerging artists. And I made a strong emphasis after studying the collection, where there were artists from the 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s, many that had entered with the Emerging Decade exhibition, basically painters from Tamayo, Lam, Mata, Cislo, Soto. And then there was a void from the 70s and 80s. And then again, we had when we had the 90s, 2000s, now we had the presence of the kind of the globalized Latin American artists entering the collection, artists like Gabriel Orozco, Ernesto Neto, Beatriz Milases, or Felix González Torres. Even Ana Mendieta entered late. So I thought it was very important to approach this void in the collection, to incorporate the work of artists that had worked during that period, including the work of Juan Downey, artists that at the time had been very present in the artistic scene. Most of them had been working in New York or the States because they were exiled from their countries because of political reasons, most of them, others because of personal reasons. And as a way also of putting them in dialogue with the artists working today, in a way to show that the contemporary art in Latin America didn't just happen yesterday, that it's not the result of the current mini economic boom, and in order also not to make kind of a triumphalist exhibition, but really kind of a more kind of critically grounded work, no, where these critical practices grounded the work of artists working today. So I'm very happy that we were able to incorporate Juan Downey's Circle of Fire work into the collection, and not only that, but that the team at the Guggenheim really embraced presenting the work and showing it in the best way I've ever seen it before, really going beyond to find the right monitors, the right technology to make it seen as it should have been seen. It's a work that I had seen many times, and really I had never seen it as well installed as here, so I'm really happy that that we made that happen. So Marilys will tell us a little bit about her experience with Juan in the Amazons, the production of Circle of Fires, how it happened. And I think another thing that's important from the idea of the tropics is this kind of recovery of indigenous knowledge and this idea of also of how to deal with the other, with the native other. So thank you, Marilys.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. We traveled through the different Indian communities from Canada all the way down to Tierra del Fuego, and we film one tribe and show it to the next tribe, and it's very interesting to see the things, similarities that they found. And we decided to go for a whole year to the Amazon jungle. We stayed there a year and 3 months.
You had partial support of the John S. Simon Guggenheim Memorial.
Yes, yes.
Of, it was $1,000, no?
There's three persons, $1,000 for a year and 3 months. But it was good. It was all we had, so it was very good. But we traveled with this truck that you see first to Mexico and Guatemala by car. We've traveled by canoes, by horse, by plane, by walking. So whatever method took us to get there. And then we did a piece that's called Video Transamericas. That is a recopilation of 14 tapes when there's a map on the floor, where you stand on the map is you're seeing Lima, Peru, and so on. This is Video Transamericas, that you see it there, you see the map and some of the monitors placed in their location. And out of the work in the Amazon also came the Circle of Fire, which is here on exhibit, and which the Guggenheim bought. And Juan had this whole thing with invisible energy. The first slide you saw was a slide of invisible energy. He used different detectors, police cars, airplanes, slight tremors, which even in New York they are, except you think it's a subway all the time. The energies would play different sounds or different words, according to it. Then that was a work he did in 1967 for a show he had at the Corcoran in 1969 in January. And then this is another work which is called Nostalgic Item, which is a drawing that he did for the work and exhibited at the Martha Jackson Gallery in 1970, which had all his memories of childhood photographs. He comes from a very large family, and his father's voice and his home. And so on. He always had this very great attachment to his country and his home. And that work was exhibited. Unfortunately, then somehow it got destroyed. We decided, after doing with different communities, this is a research in the art world. This is Plato Now, which was redone recently at the Tate, London. This is another video piece. This is. He was also very obsessed with life cycle, and we had two huge PE panels on our balcony on 20th Street, not to the gratitude of the neighbors, but they would fly in and out and do honey, and we had the whole work going on that. And he also did the one to the left is about Chilean nitrate, which is a natural sodium potash before DDT. And it was natural instead of DDT, which then destroyed that industry and got a lot of people very sick and deadly. And so he worked with a lot with energy. This is also another piece with the life cycle that was done at 112 Green Street. And this is the truck we took from New York to Guatemala and back, visiting all the different pyramids. And it's amazing the amount of pyramids in Mexico. It's just mind-boggling, the amount of them. He believed a lot in retroalimentación, the feedback. And when we went to the Yanomami, they had never seen but camera, photographic camera. They didn't have a word for it, just a gesture. They hadn't seen film, but just a gesture. They would go like that. We figured that was film and this was photograph. And we let them play with the equipment. And you see a little monitor to the left. Well, he would film this guy and then see him in the monitor and run and get behind the monitor. How could he be in front of the camera and behind the monitor? Obvious, impossible. So they took a lot of confidence in what we were doing because they were allowed to, not the precious camera, don't touch it, but they would even use the lens as a mirror and do all their face makeup on it, which was horrendous to clean. But they're very innocent people. They're the largest, most primitive tribe. They're in Stone Age. They still rub two little pieces of wood to do their fire. And unfortunately, they're going to be eliminated. They sit in 1/5 the oxygen of the world, but they sit on top of diamonds, oil, and nickel mines. It's a very rich area, which for them doesn't mean anything because they don't exploit or do any of that, but there's a lot of companies interested in that. And they're very pure. Their whole theory in life, their whole philosophy is to better themselves. And the world is divided between you are either a Yanomami or you're not. They know there's different tribes, but you're not Yanomami is what defines you, everybody lumped together. And that's a picture of Juan in the studio where we live now still in 1980. And that's his editing equipment, kind of archaic, I still have it. And this is Juan when we came back from the Amazon in 1977 with the bows and arrows that we took. I went with my youngest daughter, who was 14 at the time, and we were all very impressed with our experience there, because there's no light, there's no running water, it's just nature at its best, actually. But does have a little bit of crocodiles and a little bit of snakes, but that's not the best part of it. But if you're careful, nothing happens. And Juan got so much into the culture that he ended up shaving his head like they do and painting and using loincloth when we were there. This is a slide from the laughing alligator, which was shown here today. When they go hunting or fishing, they beautify themselves. So in case they should die, they should look their most beautiful self. So he has his face painted. He has these collars that they make, these necklaces, and feather puffs that they put on their hands. They do different styles. And so this is, you saw it in Gerardo Mosquera's presentation. They were so playful, they thought, well, Juan was filming them, why shouldn't they film him? And Juan took this picture of this one, Hepewe, who's a young shaman, filming him. And he was very proud when he would see it. He thought that was really magic at its best. So it's kind of become an icon picture in the Anomami world because it's very early with a camera. And it's when the camera was attached to the player itself. It's not the freestanding cameras that we have now. So let's see if we have another. Oh, this is a letter he wrote when we were leaving the Amazon. He wrote a letter to Leo Castelli's secretary explaining the circle of fire and explaining what he wanted to do and where to show it and asking her for advice. And she was very generous when Juan died. She told me I should have it instead of just let it stay in a file and God knows where the file would end up. But he explains the whole thing because the Yanomami live in a circular shabono and it goes from 50, 60 people to 350 depending on the size of the shabono. There you see the shabono, it's a communal house. And each family has a fire, and the fire is on 24/7 because it keeps the tigers away and the more aggressive animals away, and it also keeps them warm. They suffer a lot. It's hot in the day, but in the evening it cools down because the trees are so tall. So that's a shabono there. And here's a drawing of the shabono. This is the end of that letter. It's a drawing of the circle of fire. And
just one interruption here, Marilys, because here in that diagram that you see, I mean, you can see he's already thinking of the installation, but he's also doing the drawings that he would do every day.
Well, the meditation drawings. Because when we first went, because of the water level of the canoes, he just took videos and we had to take anything we needed for a whole year. And then I had to come out and fix the equipment, so one of the two equipments, and then I took several blocks of drawings and colored pencils and so on, and he would meditate every day for years he did that. And as he was coming down from the meditation, he would do a drawing. And the Yanomamis are very friendly, so they'd come in and they'd either sit on his lap or move him out of the hammock and draw on it. So it was kind of, you had to like, where's it mine? But he managed to do over 80, 90 drawings of the, you've seen some of them at the studio.
I'm sorry, we don't have an image, but.
Yeah. But it was a, they're called meditations. So.
Because one thing that happens when you're in the work and you sit down in the work, and we have one, you really enter kind of the cosmology of the time, space, mind.
You get
space.
Sucked into the feeling of being, that, and that's why it was designed. So when you're sitting there, so you're kind of squatting and
like
you transport yourself into a meditative state of what they do in their space.
Like almost entering the same kind of meditation space. Mm. And for me, I really understood the work. I mean, I had seen it many times, but I really understood it. When I first met Marilys, maybe it was 3 years ago, invited by Stuart Comer, who then worked at Tate Modern, and they did the reenactment, the recreation of Plato's Cave, where people sit in front of a monitor and your neural...
It's biofeedback. We sat with our backs towards the audience. It comes from the Republic, which the prisoners are held and chained with their backs to the only window that they can't see out of because it's too high. And they can only see the shadows of the people in the street going by. We were sitting towards a blank wall with lights behind us. When we were in Alpha, which is kind of hard to meditate when your friends are saying hi. But when we were in Alpha, the videos that we were sitting on the monitors would have pre-recorded images. And when you were in Beta, your monitor goes blank, it goes black, so.
And when the reenactment was done, I played the voice of Juan Downey, so I read Plato's Cave, and that information is transmitted to the meditators that are sitting. So I think that what Juan does that is really interesting is kind of he uses that kind of methods of transmitting information in kind of Beta states to achieve a kind of a Beta state when you sit down and enter into the kind of cosmology
entering into that whole, you kind of have an out-of-body experience almost because you get so absorbed into it.
So just one last question, which for me is really, really interesting. This transition from Juan's like more technological work to the Masonic work and also this kind of search for certain ways of utopia that he thought he would find first in technology, and then he went all the way to the Amazons to find kind of an utopian community. So this transition that happens in his work, even the bee colony that you had in your flat was part of this search of how to build a...
Well, he always had this thing of you had to be part of it. The sculptures would talk back to you or we'd interact, and people had to interact with them, otherwise they were just standing there. He had that participation thought going on all the time, that it could be electronic, but it could be used for transporting yourself into another space. And a lot of them worked with invisible energy.
So we leave it there with invisible energy, and we have 7 seconds left. We did perfectly, Marilys. Well done. And now we move to my left with a...
This is the fast university.
A very fast learning university. 15 minutes countdown starts. I met first Raimond in 2002 when I was invited to Puerto Rico, to Puerto Rico 02, a kind of independent biennale organized by Michel Marsouache. And suddenly Raimond and I found ourselves being thrown into a shanty town called El Naranjito, an hour away from San Juan, the capital, where we were to work with the community there. In a village that had already been, where an artist from Puerto Rico, Chemi Rosado, had already been working for a year, painting with the inhabitants of the village, their houses in different colors of green. So it was not only, let's say, a land art project, but really a community project in which he worked with the community. So that, in a way, kind of facilitated it, the work that Raimond and I did when there. I did community museum, working with the people in telling their stories through objects, which years later we renamed Arroz con Mango. And Raimond worked in doing a newspaper called Hangueando. So even since then, you were working in telling other people's stories. 2 years later, back in Puerto Rico, I met Gilda then, who came back, and at that time you were doing workshops with the local people on learning how to build boats, and the other one, how to do injertos, how do you call injertos?
Drafts.
So so always this kind of interest on connecting with other. And afterwards, you did a project, a really important project called Dibujando America, where you traveled through the South American continent and kind of learning how others draw, but also drawing what you saw. So this kind of also links to Marilys and Juan Downey's projects, Video Transamericas, where they traveled through the American continent and Juan was videotaping the different communities that he found and making them see each other. So playing again each film in each place that he stopped. So we're ready for you.
These projects cover a period of 6 years of work with other projects in between. So for us, it was a challenge, but also a very pleasant surprise. And there were a lot of things to consider. It was interesting because we can say that in a wider sense, our joint work that began in 2001 can be considered as a big Dibujando America, including this kind of project that Pablo mentioned. This big Dibujando America, well, maybe not always related to drawing in a strict sense, but it is for sure related to America, or to be more precise, in what we can agree as the Latin American context. So we found these connections between Dibujando America and all other different projects that we produced, even projects made before. So we started thinking this before. Dibujando América consisted on a series of drawings, murals, and some objects, product of several trips that we did between 2005 and 2008 through different Latin American countries. At the beginning, the idea was very simple, to draw everything, to use our capability of drawing to describe all things, not merely what we saw, but what we heard, what we read, what we watch, and register all the processes that we could access firsthand while traveling, considering drawing as a kind of notary work. Add to all this that probably because of our backgrounds, Raimond is Catalan-Colombian, and me, I am Peruvian, but born here in the United States. We are very curious about what we consider at least broad cultural context to which we belong. We wanted to know everything in first hand, and we thought the drawing was the best tool to take account of all of it. We knew, of course, that this cultural context was also full of gaps and differences, not only geographical accidents. Territory where we were able to connect to a vast amount of issues, people and places, but at the same time, with a lot of difficulties or impossibilities to establish any link in other cases.
Dibujando America was possible also because in 1998, a group of artists, including myself, did this ironic expedición al dibujo, expedition to the drawing. And the drawing is a place in Venezuela, very close to the Colombian border. We saw this map in Bogota and we decided to make this trip to there. We can say that America, or at least the Americas that came out of colonization, were possible and fueled in a great sense because of drawing and the power of representation, because all the imagery that circulate between America and Europe. I'm not going to elaborate a lot more about this project, but just point the ironic fact that drawing, the tool that contribute to build America had a place on a map, let's repeat, a drawing of America. Now I'm going to step a bit out of the script and tell something that happened in the plane that took us here to New York. When we were arriving to the airport, they put a video on the monitor, on the TV set of the plane, and there was a promotional touristic commercial of the Chilean air transportation company. And one of the mottos of the of this video was related, as I said, to tourism, was wealth to be discovered. So again, we have, as the professor told us this morning, all these colonial frames still visible. And when we did Dibujando America, of course, we had in mind that we cannot escape from this the background. To apply drawing to America is not an innocent job, no? Because of all the things I told before. And it's not an innocent job, and still work to be done around it, about it, as I told, related this motto in the video. Also, in Dibujando America, we ask ourselves about our position as artists, travelers, tourists, people with the power to capture and share their versions of things. We like to thought of ourselves as traveling artists, but for a big amount of people, we're just tourists. This also led us to interrogate our strategies, to put in question our ways to see things. In this sense, for us, it was equally important to be seen, to be drawn under the gaze of the others. So we systematically were portrayed by every street artist draftsman that we encounter on the streets of city as Caracas, Santa Marta, or Trujillo. It's me and Gilda, no? Believe it or not. So now I'm going to show some, I think it's four drawings, and to tell the story short, as Gilda pointed a moment ago, we start with this notarial aim to be able to register everything, like this view of Caracas from the Monte Avila. And also we began to play with the name of places. In a trip we did from Venezuela to Lima by road, we found that in every country there was a place called The Pleasure, El Placer. I know the story of Colombia more than the other stories of the other countries. I knew that sometimes the most horrible massacres in the countryside in Colombia, for example, happen in places with that kind of names, you know, The Pleasure, El Porvenir, La Bonanza, etc. And also this piece show our most part of the work in Dibujando America was black and white, and we didn't break clearly with this association with America and color, America and exoticism, and so on. But, at the beginning of the, you know, the first trip, I think we did this map in a didactical way with all the things we found, but later on the course of the project, we did several different maps, and that's the map of the things we didn't understand, which are a lot, no? You can see in red the itineraries, in blue the borders and sea, and then all the things we were not able to understand. And this is one of the contradictions, no? We were very close, very close to a lot of things in Latin America, but very far away at the same time, as soon as you abandon your city, your neighbor, or your friends group. No? So what we did at the end of the project, we tried to undraw, redraw, or draw backwards. Those are neologism or inverted terms that helped us to address representation.
To connect with the works that we presented in the exhibition, tell that during one of those trips of Dibujando America, we came across with the Amazon library, a specialized library on that territory belonging to the Augustinians in Iquitos. This Peruvian Amazon city surrounded by the forest where you can only get by plane or boat. We were very impressed by this situation of having a place to preserve knowledge, science, history, in the middle of the most changing environment. And let's say changing because we can associate forest with a place that renews all the time, but also because, of course, we all know how endangered it can be as well. For the cultures of the forest, the jungle is a kind of a library where knowledge and life is all together. For us, we tend to see the jungle as landscape or environment or source of raw materials, and we dare to project our fantasies on it. Of course, this is simplification because we must take on account that there is also different ways of being Amazonian. There's a difference between being Amazonian as an indigenous in the middle of the jungle or to be an Amazonian in an urban environment. As we say in the video shown here, an uncomfortable eagerness, in the jungle there is a city, in that city there is a library, and in the library is the jungle. With for us, it is another jungle, and we address the work there as to get lost in the jungle. So we try to get lost in the library. This library, its subject is the Amazon culture. So there coexists a lot of materials of Amazon thematic. What we did was to scan a lot of these materials with no previous script, just getting lost on those archives. Then we produced a series of pieces with this material, trying to point all these mediation processes that we came across. So we scanned photographs, drawings, all kinds of graphics, and also music scores, and produce the video that we were showing here. We produced a series of drawings, some of them shown here as well. And these images that we are seeing now belong to a work called Abstract, that is a slideshow. The idea was to put together a lot of graphic material, decontextualizing it in order to put together material that come from different disciplines, like, and try to see if they could start telling a different story. We put together, for example, meteorological graphics, or how do you say the name?
Pasatiempos
from the newspapers.
Connect the dot.
Or maps, of course, architectural graphics.
Geological.
As I was saying, the idea was to put all these materials in the same level and trying to erase the categories of the disciplines that they were coming from and try to articulate a new narrative and see what things about the Amazon context or a specific context can they tell.
Well, this is the last image we are going to see. It belongs to our last work. It's the overlap of 21 Amazonian maps. It can be shown until the end of the year, I think, inside Santa Fe, New Mexico. For us, it's a way to join Dibujando America and all the Amazonian Library project. In a way, it's the dream of a cartographer, the idea to put all the maps one upon the other, but at the same time, it's the nightmare of the cartographer, no? Because you cannot read nothing. There is a jungle of information. Also, the exhibition in Santa Fe is called Unsettled Landscapes. And what we can see here is in a place that maybe some people still consider unsettled, is just settled in many, many, many ways. Thank you.
For me, what's important about your drawing projects, and we've had this conversation before, is that you use drawing not as the colonizers use it or the explorers, not as Humboldt used it in a way. I mean, he was drawing America, but they were also drawing the resources available for exploitation. So there's and I've said it in a text that I wrote about your work, in a way you are de-drawing America, no? Or even to add what we learned today at the university, at the Unknown University, you're decolonizing America through drawings, no? Kind of allowing for other drawings or other images to emerge, no? Which I think has this parallel with Juan Downey's work, again, in how to relate to the other and let the other time and the other cosmology emerge, no? This other kind of repressed, repress otherness and repress other ways of living, of seeing, of being, you know, so.
Well, for us drawing, it's, what we try to do is to put down the, low down the representational part and going up with making things with images, no? That's, some of the drawings can be, or the series can be presented as a kind of modest visual essays, no? But also we enjoy sketching from life. This is, I think it's quite option.
Yeah, it's clear that at the beginning of the Dibujando America project, it seemed that it was possible to draw everything. And in the course of it, we were more and more confronted to limitations with a lot of considerations. So then it became that the drawing was part of the problem itself, and it had to be problematized. So it changed everything.
Which is, I think, in the same way Juan also problematized video and registration of the other, no?
And right. He went just to do video and sound. We took all kinds of sounds. That's how we told time, whether the crickets were singing or the frogs. After a while, you get to know when they wake up early in the morning. But the drawing, it was because he meditated, and coming out, he would do it. But it was very hard because there was so much to see and so much to experience. It took him a while to be able to get into that rhythm, because you want to draw everything, and it's impossible, even if you had a crew of 10 people doing it. But he didn't want to draw like what was happening, but what he was perceiving, not what was happening to him. And he had some Yanomami, both men, actually more men than children, who had never seen a pencil or a paper. And they did magnificent drawings, just incredible drawings, like with Saturn and everything, because their imagination is so pure and so clean. They would draw a plane that they had seen once go by, but perfect. But it would take us many more hours if we hadn't seen something, you know, like a special tree or something. So it was quite an experience. But I can relate very much to your trip, because there's the drawing part of not only geographical, but experience, because it's really more experience what you perceived at the time you did the drawing. They're not accurate. And it's just so much to see and so much to absorb. Impossible. You get to do a bunch and then that's it. But that's a gorgeous part, drawing that.
Another point that for me is important is, and happens, so I attempted to try to happen in the exhibition, is again connecting the different Amazonic knowledge, no? Which I think many are disconnected. Even, I mean, I come back from Rio de Janeiro, like last week, an exhibition of artists from the Amazons opened in at the Museum of Art in Rio, Pablo Herkenhoff Museum, and it's only about Brazilian Amazonian artists. No, so even the Amazons today still is disconnected as much of Latin America is. No, so trying to create this kind of connected bodies of knowledge. One thing that's very interesting for me about your work is that that you go into a library that is disappearing, a collection of books and images that. That will sooner or later, a lot of that material will disappear because of the weather and the humidity. And there's a phrase at the end of your video, which I don't remember, but which questions this idea of what does it mean to collect, to keep. And for me, again, it deals with dealing with a collection. You know, how do you work with a collection? How do you keep things alive? How do you make those messages, transmit the messages to the future also? So I don't know if you want to talk a little bit about that.
Well, that makes me think that for us, living with these materials that come belong to our collection, of course, we approach that situation by trying to use the material to tell different things, to make them, I don't know, move, put it in different, try to read it in different ways. And that was our main.
Yeah, in that case, our work, or especially the video, is not a portrait of the Amazon, or it's more. It has to do more with how the images construct this territory, no? And not only the images that is supposed to construct, like maps or graphics, but also this.
Can you turn off the slides, please? We're not ready for it yet. Oh, sorry. Sorry. It's okay. No, it's okay.
Yeah, it takes time.
It was this other one up here that was getting us nervous.
The slow projector of the fast university.
And another thing I wanted to comment, just to relate it, what will come next. When you talk about the Yanomami's drawing an airplane, and I would wanted to connect this to another great exhibition that I saw 2 weeks ago in Sao Paulo, Historias Mestizas, co-curated by Adriano Pedrosa, who's here with us, and who in one way puts at the same level and at the same level of dialogue work produced by people of black origin and tells the story of slavery, but also the drawings and made by Yanomami and indigenous and beautiful drawings of a burial. So trying to put everything at the same level and ending with this kind of distinction between indigenous, folkloric.
Or people.
So maybe that's something that will come later in the conversations if we have time that Adriano can also talk about that. And which also links us to one of the next exhibitions, which the next case studies which are going to be presented, which is Julieta González, Etnografías, Modo Empleo, which was a really important exhibition that happened in Venezuela, and in a way presented artists with an ethnographic practice. We still have a few minutes before starting the next conversation, which is at 4, the next curator case studies. So if anybody has a comment or wants to have a question to our speakers or wants to add to the conversation, we're very happy to have you come up to the microphone and contribute to this conversation.
Thank you.
I see your drawings more about you than about the Amazon, about what the Amazon embedded in your heart as what you took from it. You gave to it, but the impression it gave you back. Your drawings are more your experience, like the jungle documented you through your own hand and pencil, but it's more your experience and the actual photographic situation of the Amazon, which I find very interesting.
Thank you.
Anybody else?